Started. Session 8. It's old news by now. I'm going to get started handing these out because I always forget until the very end of my little spiel. And this year I won't. Well, this session I won't. So, we're a long way down the road now. Seems like a long time ago we started here. Fun fact, this is my first final session of the CEC. Because my kid was born on the actual last session of the CEC, so I didn't actually attend it, but I've been assured it was amazing. And it was a little different than what we're doing this year. I'm excited for some of the changes that we have. So that's everything that we've done from the very beginning until now. 8 weeks, we talked to Craig in the first session. How many of you remember Craig? Yeah, right? Kind of hard guy to forget. He talked to us about how to pitch, which we're going to see a little bit later tonight. He talked to us about how to get customers in your door. We talked to the entrepreneur panel. We talked to people that had participated in the CEC before that kind of gave you that real feedback on what it's like when you're in business. And we talked to MNP a little bit about things you need to think a little bit about. We talked about that self-evaluation. And I think I've said that from the beginning, how important that self-evaluation of an entrepreneur is to know your own strengths and weaknesses. We talked about the business model canvas and the value proposition. For those of you that had them filled out, I'll take them here tonight. I'm also going to extend the deadline for that for the tickets. So you can submit them digitally by the end of business day tomorrow. Okay? So go ahead and do that, and you guys are going to be entered in to win some of those tickets for Greatness and Leadership, which is going to be fantastic this year. So we've taken you through most of the steps of the business planning process. We talked about market feasibility with BusinessLink, how you do that research, prove that there's a market out there. We talked about the systems that you put in place, the financials, where if you're going to open up a business. Tonight, Bill's going to talk to us a little bit about putting it all together. So I have the housekeeping items that I always have that we're going to go through. And then, as I mentioned last week, Bill Halley's going to be joining us for a little bit here. Bill's someone that I work with on a fairly regular basis because of the RINSA partnership. And I believe that Bill has also been the longest standing partner of the CEC besides Community Futures itself. He's someone that can really help entrepreneurs get started. And we'll get to him in a couple minutes. First, the housekeeping. Everybody knows what's first. This is the last session, so I just want to prepare you. In unison, just once, it would be my absolute happiest moment. What is the deadline for business plan submissions?
March 29th.
That was good. I'm happy. And I tell people, you know, you guys have a month from now until then to get that business plan together. Yeah.
Where do we submit it?
Online. That's a good question. So you can go to the Chinook Entrepreneur Challenge website, and it's all done digitally. That's the only way that submissions can be made, is that way you upload the actual business plan itself to that. It's a really easy process to follow, and we can talk a little bit about that in a little bit here. But I tell everybody, even if you don't think that you stand a chance at winning, or you don't think that you're ready to open this year, one of two things is going to happen if you put a business plan in. One, you don't reach the finals, but you get feedback. Feedback from three screeners who have looked at your plan and evaluated it and said, this is a shortfall, you need to think about this. This is something that's really good, expand on this. These are people that look at business plans every day and can evaluate them. And that type of feedback, just like that, is so critically important. And then come back next year, because the only thing that precludes you from participating next year is if you're a finalist. And that's the other thing that can happen. If you submit a business plan and you make it to the finals, maybe you're more ready than you thought you were. But I highly suggest that everybody put something in. And in the next month, and I'll talk about it a little bit later, I'm here to help you guys do that. So last week, we talked to Paul from Westland Insurance, and we were visited by RBC, who talked about funding. So does anyone have any takeaways from last week that they remember particularly, other than the milk infused river that killed a bunch of fish? Did anybody Google that? What was your takeaway?
Insurance agents and brokers difference, and yep, getting the actual people to work for you instead of for the insurance companies.
So. Yeah, totally. That's a great point, because insurance companies care about insurance companies, right? And so it's good to have someone on your side. It's just like everything else we've talked about, surround yourself with specialists. What about the funding side? That was a big talk, right? Kind of scary when you're talking about debt that you're taking on.
I have takeaways that I'll love to share with you. You guys know that I'm particularly passionate about that finance side. Take smart debt. I'll tell you right now that as soon as you walk out this door, the minute you go into a bank, that you step foot in that door, the person you're sitting across from wants to give you debt. That's what they want to do. That's their job. They want you to take a credit card. They want you to take a line of credit. The person that stops them is a credit analyst in Vancouver or Calgary. And so, you know, the story I always use is when I went to get my mortgage with my wife, we didn't have car payments, and she was about to go on mat leave, but she was working full time. And they told me that we qualified for a $450,000 mortgage because that was his job. I cannot afford a $450,000 mortgage. That's house poor. And I'm not saying that, that's an extreme. And that person, I don't think they're a mortgage broker anymore. But the fact is that when you go in, you need to make the right decision for your business. I see a lot of people that hang themselves on debt because it's easy to get, but it's a high interest rate and they can't afford it. So be really careful. And there's different ways that you guys can finance your business. Equity, win the CEC maybe, free money. That's the order, guys. It goes free money, and then depending on your business, equity, and then debt. Because debt is that hurdle that is on your neck for the next 5 years, 6 years, right? Sometimes it's absolutely necessary, but don't take risky choices. And that's my soapbox. So we'll cover some more information a little bit later on, but before we get too much later, I'd like to pass it over to Bill. As you guys know, I like my speakers to kind of speak for themselves. And as I said, Bill's someone that I've worked with on quite a few occasions. And whenever I have an entrepreneur that has questions, especially on the technical side, Bill is the person to talk to about it. He's helped entrepreneurs for a very long time and has a lot of experience, not only doing that, but also in manufacturing as well. And he's got a very interesting story. So without further ado, let's have a round of applause.
Hopefully you'll be doing that when I'm done. I should stand in front of the camera, they told me. I'm usually one that likes to walk around and talk to people, but I don't like to lecture people, I like to talk to people. Now this works really, really, really well if I have a whole bunch of questions. Because otherwise, when I leave here, I'm going to assume that all you guys have taken in all the stuff I've said and you get it, right? Because otherwise, how do I know, right? So anyway, it's me, Bill Halley. It's not Haley, Halley. I'm a technology development advisor with Alberta Innovates. Been with them for almost 6 years now. Yes, my focus is on technological innovations and inventions, but given that I work with the Regional Innovation Network of Southern Alberta, which I'll talk about in a minute, we'll talk to anyone who has a business, anyone who's a startup, and then we can refer you to people who can help you if you're not in technology. So keep asking questions and keep trying to follow up with business advisors, because they're the ones that will help you. I'm part of a regional network, provincial regional network. Alberta Innovates is an agency of the provincial government. We get funding from Economic Development and Trade. And as you can see, there is 9 regions around the province now. Medicine Hat, Lethbridge, Calgary, Red Deer, Edmonton, the latest one in Lloydminster, and Grand Prairie. So the 7 of us around the province, and there's 10 technology development advisors, or TDAs as we call ourselves. So there's 3 in Calgary, 2 in Edmonton, the rest of us are scattered around the province. Now, all these TDAs work with these RINs, or regional innovation networks. You guys, and you guys on dialing in, are really, really lucky. You're lucky for a number of reasons. You're lucky because they have this program here, Community Futures, the only program of its kind, as I understand it, and certainly the best one in Western Canada, so you're really lucky from that point of view. The other reason why you're lucky, they're in this region. This is RINSA, the Regional Innovation Network, Southern Alberta. Southern Alberta used to be from Nanton South and Tabor West. Now we have people from around Calgary want to get involved in RINSA. And we have clients all over the province in fact, all over the country coming to Alberta. What makes RINSA different is the leadership and the makeup of the partnership. The three folks on top here are the funded partners in RINSA. They get funding from Alberta Innovates. The Lethbridge College, Economic Development Lethbridge, the Tech Connect facility, I know some of you have been there. It's in the north side, Tech Connect, and the U of L, the research office. I have an office in each one of these locations. We also have Community Futures Lethbridge, who has been our partner with us for all the time we've been around, over 6 years now. The National Research Council, we're lucky to have a representative of the National Research Council here, their IRAP program, which is an Industry Research Assistance Program. They deal a lot in technologies as well. TDE, that's me. Alberta Southwest, if you take Highway 2, all the towns and villages west of Highway 2, this is part of Alberta Southwest. That includes Fort McLeod, Pincher Creek, I think Claire's home is part of that too. Then you have the Blood Tribe Economic Development Group. They're now part of RINSA. And then South Grow, Highway 2, east of Highway 2, and that includes Tabor, Coaldale, Vulcan, and places like that. So RINSA is the only regional network in the province that's truly regional, from Tabor West and now from Calgary South. The beauty of having a group like this, you guys are in the middle, by the way. In case you don't know, you're an SME, small and medium-sized enterprise. Small could be, some say less than 50, we like to think of less than 10 people. And medium size, well, it can range from 50 to 100, 150. You do the math, it's just big for us. The beauty of having a region like this is that through any one of these partners, you can get connected to other partners. And then through that network, you can get connected to other people outside of Lethbridge who can help you. So if we don't have the expertise here to help you, we can relate you to someone else who does. So always come and ask, because you don't know, there may be someone somewhere who could help you. Okay? I'll give you an example of that. We had some ladies from Stirling. They had a product. They had a company from Lebanon who wanted to work with them and be a distributor in the Middle East. Well, through our connections with Economic Development and Trade, the branch manager here contacted the consulate there, and with 24 hours, they had an analysis of that company in Israel, from Lebanon through the Israel office, all because of the connections. So use the connections, use the network, okay? So this is what we do. I'm not gonna read this too much, but business advice, obviously, all the TDAs, all 10 of us around the province, have expertise in different businesses. Mine is mainly in manufacturing, my time in Lethbridge. Although I did spend a few 7 years in healthcare. I was the director in the old St. Michael's when they had the old hospital there. Healthcare is not very healthy. So I went back to industry because that's where the real business was as far as I'm concerned. So I did, so forgive me for saying I was all in industry. I wasn't. I had some time in healthcare. Thank goodness I'm out of it. So we can give out business advice. We do review business plans. I do that all the time. I'll review a reasonably sized business plan. Someone came to me a few weeks ago with a business plan that was 155 pages. I told that person, if you can get all your main points down to less than 10, I may read it. 8 pages, probably. Any more than 20, I'll tell you guys, I will not read it. So get into the important stuff, right? Our time is valuable. So we do market foresight and all this other good stuff, product development, referrals, very important for you. Technology is the main focus for us TDAs, technology development advisors. We do assessments, business development assessments for technologies and scale up, connecting people to technological companies. We help develop tech-based businesses, the same situation here with technology, but more novel advances in technology and novel and knowledge-based industries. So we're looking for inventions, novel inventions, adaptations of inventions, if we're looking at purely technology. That's my technology hat on. So if you come to me with a technology, I want to know how unique that is. And if you look in the words of a patent, how non-obvious is that technology? In other words, it wasn't obvious if I took this and took this, I add it together, I get a new technology. Okay? So from technology point of view, novelty is key. From a business point of view, it's going to be marketing. And we'll help you with the businesses as well. Referrals through the Innovation Network, networks, because there are a number of them around the province, is very important for you. You see through this presentation, we talk about networking, the value of networking. Don't discount that, please. The value of networking can be very powerful for you if you do it right. Okay? So, if you're not in technology, you're not a technological business, talk to us anyway, because it is free. Well, if you pay your taxes, it's not free. You've paid for it already. So, but my time is free for you, and I spend many, many hours with clients. So, technology, so I'm going to switch over to technology. Some of this may or not apply to some of you, but we really, I nearly need to talk to you because that's core to what I do, is technology. When you have a technology, you have to do a discovery. You have to determine where the customer's motivations are and their preferences and their needs to buy your product. I had a lady, I'm going to give you lots of examples, by the way, because they're real life stuff. Lady sent us an email and she says, I've got a product that I can guarantee, wow, I can guarantee people will buy. As a business owner, we're setting you starting up, you can't guarantee a dang thing. It's your customers who will guarantee they'll buy your product, not you sitting in your office saying you're going to buy my product. So you have to do a discovery. Find out where the customers are. Why would they consistently buy your product? Think of it as a string, right? Market pull works. Can I push it? Consistently means that they're going to come back over and over again to buy your product. It's not very good if you have a one-off purchase all the time. They come, buy your product, and go. You can have a lot of sales and then nothing. So you need reoccurring sales, no matter what your business. So market pull, now we're going to talk a lot about markets, folks. I know you've been through this in other sessions, but marketing is key to every business, technology, general business, wherever you are. If you don't do your marketing, you will not succeed. I have been at this stuff for nigh on 6 years now, and we have advised close to 500 companies, small, growing companies, startups in different stages. Probably 95% of them have not done market research and don't know where the markets are. So at that point, we say, stop. You got to do your market research. It's the biggest failing, particularly of technology companies, because a lot of them think, my gadget is so beautiful, as soon as I start my website, the money's just going to come roaring in. Guess what? It doesn't work, because they didn't do the marketing. Why is your technology truly unique? Right? It has to be really unique. It can't be something you just, I like the color of this one, so it makes it unique. It doesn't, right? And this is where it's important for people to be open-minded when they look at their technology. Because quite often, people would come to me and say, Bill, I got this great idea, I'm going to go patent it. And we would tell most people, don't patent your idea. It's way too expensive. It's really, really expensive to defend it. You have to defend it in other countries. Today, to defend a patent in the US, $250,000, $300,000. So one storyline would tell you, and a patent agent will tell you, unless you're going to make a $10 million on that product, on that technology, don't patent it. And I would say the same. Some people do patent searches, right? But I've got this technology, this wonderful thing, I invented that. And then they go out and they do a patent search and they find a whole list of patents, but they have a reason why that their product is different than the patent. They don't keep an open mind. They don't really look at it and say, you know, that really is very similar to what I thought I would invented. Because if you go to spend all this money to go out and market a product, and then you get a cease and desist letter, that's bad. Plus, governments will not give you money. If they find a patent that's similar to yours and you're trying to get a grant, governments will not fund you because they will not fund someone who could be infringing on a patent. So be very cautious when you talk about this patenting stuff. Trademarking, different. Remember, when you go to trademarking, by the way, go to a trademarking agent. Don't go to a lawyer. Right? You have to go to an agent. If you're ever going to do patenting, go to a patenting agent. Okay. Oops. Proof of concept. We're going to hear us talk about this more and more. We call it an MVP, minimum viable product. So I have a technology and I've developed a prototype and it works and I'm thinking people are going to go buy it. That's not the way to approach this, because if you've done your market research, then you develop your product to this minimum viable product level, which is typically 60, 70%, maybe 80% to where you want it to be. You take that product out to your customers, let them try it, test it, get your feedback, so you do some revisions. You take it back out to the customer, let them try it again, and you'll bring it back until you get to that 85, 90% point, and you say, okay, I'm ready to launch my product. Doesn't have to be perfect, right? I'm going to talk about this in a minute. Market entry strategy. You see, market's all over this thing. You have to have a strategy to enter a market. I had a lady who made dresses a few years ago, very colorful dresses, very nice. And her business plan said she was going to make $1 million in the first year, which I thought was great. She hardly made part of that business. Hell of a lot of dresses you'd have to make, mind you. So this was in November. So I said to her, okay, that's good. So what are you going to do on January 1st? So in January, you make the first $90,000. Do the math. $1 million divided by 12. How are you going to do that in January to make the first $90,000? Blank stare. So then, of course, stop that and go back to the basics again. So the market entry strategy can't be, I hit the green button in my website and I sit there and wait for the cash registers to start ringing. If you believe that, you're in the wrong room, right? So because it doesn't work like that. A strategy is just that. You're going to have this, what we call a valley of death, right? Where you're in your business, you're putting out all this money, right? Getting your business going, getting it started, maybe have a product, but there's no sales, right? So the money's going out, there's no money coming in. So there's a point where you say, do I keep doing this? Keep putting this money out, no money coming in? But the strategy should take that into account. This valley of death, and there is a valley of death because that's the point where most people kind of give up. Or as Jason would tell you, they run to the bank and take out a whole bunch of loans, which is bad because they're panicking, because it wasn't in the plan. You have a plan, you can accept some of this stuff will happen, but you plan to go through it, right? It's not a catastrophe. So we in this regional network, we support entrepreneurs, people like yourself, in many different ways. We can refer you to value-added regional services. It may not just be in the RIN, it could be any other number of other places. We have people in the Tech Connect facility. I know some of you have met Bruce Thurston over there. He's a great management advisor. He's not in our RIN specifically, but we can refer you to people like that. Use the network. The knowledge industry, I have an office at the college Applied Research, and I have an office here at the University Research. So if you had a product or a service that needed research, we can connect you to those folks and do some work with you. coaching and mentoring, that's really at the core of what we do as technology development advisors. Yes, we do have funding programs, but you will see I won't talk about those very much because that's going to be a way down the list. When someone calls me and says, "Hi, Bill, I hear you have a granting program. Where do I apply?" I say, "Well, you go online and apply, but you're not going to get a reference from me because I don't know you." We're all about relationships, right? We have to understand where the business is, where the business wants to go, what the strategy is, and sometime along the way, that's where the grant application is. It's not the first thing you do. It has to be the right grant at the right time for the right reasons. But we do that. But coaching and mentoring is what we do for the main part. Connection to local businesses, we've done that too. We had a young lad here from the university who had an idea for biodegradable plastics, if I remember, way back in the day. And I connected him to a company in town who manufactures plastic tanks, and they made their deal and they made their technology NDAs and that kind of stuff. So that's what all, that's all he did. Just connected two people and they did business. We have this platform, I'm going to talk about it later, so you can take that down now, connectica.ca. I'm going to talk about it later in a bit more detail. As the word implies, it's there to help connect business to business, people who may be looking for your services. But like I say, I'll go into that in a bit more detail. And we'll review client business plans, as I mentioned. Some people are really, really nice to people when they review the business plan. Some of us can be a little bit more critical, shall I say. Because guess what, guys, it's business, right? You're going to put your life and your heart and your soul and your money into this. You don't need someone telling you everything's wonderful and good and great, and you're going to make a whole bunch of money when you know you're not. What we want to do is help you along the way, critique it, change it, so it becomes something you can work with and deal with, right? That's what's important for you. We respect very much that entrepreneurs, that's the key thing in this province. That's what drives businesses and industry in this province, is that 95% of companies are small and medium-sized enterprises, just like you. So we want to help. So along that journey, you have to take in this advice to help you change your direction sometimes, because you're not going to go 0 to 100. Guys, it's not like a string. It doesn't work like that. Sorry. It's going to go like this a little bit along the way. As long as that track is still kind of heading up, that's good. But if you know yes, and you're going to go like that, then we want to be somewhere intervening here to help you go back on track, right? So we do help, and we do want to help. You mean business plans? Remember, a startup is a temporary organization. You can't be in perpetual startup. Yeah, there's a point where, yeah, I've got to start making money here. I've got to get out of this valley of death, right? So the goal is to, this is really important, I'm going to read this, to search for the problem a customer has, not you, and develop solutions the customer will consistently buy. There's warehouses full of technology that no one wanted to buy. So the connection here is customer. You have to do your links to your customer. We're going to talk a lot about this. Marketing. With no market to chase, there's no interest in your product. Definitely. If you have a market out there to chase your product, then you're just someone else trying to sell the same thing. And you can be in the yellow pages like everybody else. And take your chance. What sets you apart is knowing your market. Customers don't buy products. They buy solutions. And it's in its crudest form, and I know this may sound, oh yeah, right, but it's true. You go out and buy a snowblower to blow snow. You don't get it to cut your lawn, right? Now, I know that sounds wrong. That's obvious, I mean, obvious. But that's the level of thinking sometimes you have to think of, in that customers are looking for solutions. Sometimes they don't realize that they'll come up with, they have this problem because they don't know there's a solution there. Like Uber, for example, right? The two guys invented Uber, one's Canadian from San Francisco, nighttime in Paris. You've ever been in Paris trying to get a taxi? It's tough at the best of times, at midnight when it's cold. And one guy saying, wouldn't it be good if you could just, through your iPhone, pick up a taxi or a driver coming past as it's going in the same direction? And then ways to pay it without using cash because it were different currencies. And boom, you get Uber because they solved the problem for customers. But then customers realized they had a problem, so they bought Uber. So, but that's so true. It's a good example. Go out and talk to your customers. We had a program just finished a few months ago called the Discovery Program. We work with Innovate Calgary to deliver that program right here in Lethbridge. I'm going to talk about another program in a minute. That's done. But what they had, what they did is they had the people involved in that program actually go out and interview clients. They went out to the ball and they did it all over the city. So you go on this website, it gives you some tips to ask your clients, ask your potential customers. Yes, you have to go out and interview them. Ask them. Don't assume. Executive summaries. Your executive summary in your business plan, that really grabs you, right? That's the thing. When I read that paragraph, I look at that and think, man, this is great. Whatever the business is, doesn't matter what it is, it's that part of the, man, they've got it together. They've got a great idea going here. Or they're different. They're doing the same thing, but they're doing it differently, a little bit of a different approach to it. That executive summary is what grabs you, right? It's important. Financial and action plans. I know Bruce was here talking about cash flows, I think. I often talk to people who are starting their business plans, and I say to them, you should know your cash flow, and you should know your how many invoices you have outstanding. And they say to me, well, I've got a bookkeeper that does that. Wrong answer, definitely the wrong answer. You own your business, you got to know the numbers. You got it. And I'm not asking you to be an accountant. No, that's for Bruce and those kind of guys. But you got to know your numbers. You got to be able to say, I have so many accounts outstanding, I have so many invoices pending, I know what my margins are, net margins, gross margins. You got to know what all those are. So you might think, well, Bill, I want to do this. This is my technology. I love it. I want to do this stuff. That's business stuff I want to give to someone else. That's not running a business. You got to know the numbers. All the details you can pass on to your bookkeeper, all the mechanics of doing it for the accountant, sure, you can do that. But don't rely on them, because you own the business. You should know your business and how it all works. And action plans. People come with business plans and say, yeah, I'm going to make all this money, I've got this finances, it all works. And I say, well, where's the action plan? What are you going to do from now, the end of the month, or this quarter, this year? Quite often, when I meet someone at the start of a year, I'll say to them, where do you want to be at the end of this year, end of 2017? Where do you want to be? Oh, I want to be here. Okay, is that reasonable? Is it workable? And it's one of these, is it a stretch? In other words, it's not just complacency, I'm just getting there anyway, just by showing up every day. But it's going to be a bit of a stretch. But how are you going to get there? Where do you want to be at the end of 2017? Great. So do you divide it up into 12 months, or four quarters? Or do you divide it up in some way that it's manageable for you? Whatever that is, that's when your action starts. So that lady was going to earn $1 million in her first year. She had no action plans. So you have to say, okay, at this point, and what's good about that is 6 months, a year from now, you'll look back and say, I did that. I was in control of my business. Because last year, or 6 months ago, I set out to go from here to here, not up to here to here. And that's going to keep me online to improve my business and my market. But I did that. And it makes you feel in control of your business plan. It makes them feel in control of your business and what your marketing's doing. And you can feel good. You take some pride in that. You drive the business. Don't let it drive you. Right? So some objectives. I'll just go through these. Three things, really. Hearts, minds, and and wallets, in that order. Grab the heart, give something for the mind to think about, and then go for the dollars. That's what we advise these days. So, hearts, so why should I pay attention to you, your business? Why should I pay attention to your product and your service? What makes you different? So that's something you have to, your customers have to grab. Where is the problem? Who's the customers, and where is their pain? The pain could be just about anything that I just don't like doing. I need someone to fix this problem for me, whatever it may be. So understand the problem and where the customers are. Solutions. How do you eliminate the pain? So I'm Uber, I'm going to eliminate your pain because I can give you an idea when that this ride is going to come. It's going to be in your doorstep. A good idea of how much it's going to cost. You don't need any cash. It's safe. That's pretty good. So it's eliminating my pain, because if I'm in here on New Year's Eve and I'm trying to find a taxi in 5 hours from now, that's painful. So think about that. Value propositions. What's in it for them? Not what's in it for you. It's what's in it for them. That's what they're going to give you money for. All the stuff we do, by the way, as technology development advisors, is leads to commercialization. We do believe in companies making money, right? Because that's how you're going to survive. There is social enterprise, for sure. That's good. But you want to survive, you're going to make money. So you have to figure out what's in it for them. Market, again, we talked about that again. How many customers and what percentage of that market will you get? Companies come to me, individuals sometimes. I had one there yesterday, as a matter of fact. So, Bill, this market is $17 billion. So what? I hear that all the time. $100 billion market. So many bill. So what? It doesn't matter to me at all. What matters to me is what's your plan to get a little bit of that market in the time frame that you've allotted yourself. Is it the first quarter? Is it next year? Is it a 3-year plan? Don't tell me how many billions of dollars. I don't care about that, to be honest. What I care about is what's your action plan to get that little slice of that market. And then a year later, you get a bigger slice. And then a year later, you get a bigger slice. And all along, you make money. So it's going to be a small percentage. This is important. Every one of you folks out there own a business. So you are the de facto salesperson of your business. So if you come to me and say, you know, Bill, I kind of got this idea, which I kind of think it's going to work. And, you know, people like my idea and people are giving me money and I'm just going to give it a try. That's not very good salesmanship. You know what I mean? Rather than, this is where I would, for one, for the people in the camera, I'd be out there talking to you. I like to talk to people. Say, I've got this product, it does this, I know you have this pain, I can deliver this to you tomorrow for this amount of money, and I know it's going to fix your problem. Very affirmative kind of actions from you as the owner of the business. I like owners to be very proactive and very kind of stand up and project themselves, because that's what you have to do to your customer. They have to take confidence in that I'm buying something from you, that you've done a lot of work on researching or developing your service or your product, and I got this relationship with you because I can relate to you. You can't relate to someone who doesn't have a compelling body language, right? So grab their attention. Any of you who are going to do a pitch, grab their, you may only have five minutes, grab their attention. You're selling. And whenever I'm a judge, I'm going to look there, I'm looking at you, I'm looking at the team, I'm looking at the management of this. What the object, what the services, that's okay. As long as you've done your marketing. The product, the technology, that's okay. I'm looking at that. In a 5-minute pitch, you're looking at the people that are up there selling to you, right? Dynamics. Don't be going looking at lessons, giving me a pitch looking at the bloody screen, right? I mean, right? I don't want to see the back of your head. I see you. So you don't, so many times your people doing that? Turn the screen off and talk to you, right? That's what I like. Hearts, minds, now grab the minds, right? Where's the competition? Who else is out there? Why are you or how are you different? Why should I pick you? Why should I think of you when I think of getting this service? Right? Technology, if it is technology, what sets you apart? Is it easy to copy or easy to recreate? Is there barriers to entry? If there's a patent out there, for example. Very important. Skills. You know the market and can effectively manage the finances. Market we're talking about again, and finances we're talking about again. You might be a welder somewhere, and I work with quite a number of them, great folks, but you're not just going to go out there and weld, you're going to manage your business, which is the finance, which is the market. It's a skill that good entrepreneurs have. And then eventually, we talk about these go-to-market programs. What's your marketing plan, market entry, and your scaling? I mean, if you come to it with a marketing plan and say, I'm going to get to here, then I'm going to go there. It's not very good for your cash flow. I'm going to get to here, then I'm going to get to here, and everywhere along is an action plan. So, scaling is important. Last thing is their wallets. This is where you try and get the money, right? What's your revenue model? Cash flow and revenue. I know Bruce talked to you about cash flows and stuff like that, so I'm sure you all took it to heart. And you all know about cash flow and that. Forecasts, very important. How much money will you make? When are you going to make it? Milestones. Practical implementation plan. Again, this is how are you going to implement your plan to get to where you need to go? Someone else isn't going to do it for you. Right? If you go to someone, hey Bill, can you help me implement my business plan? I'll review it for you. I'll work with you to refine it. It's your business. It's your plan. You do it. It's like the three guys in the bar, right? They all get their heads down, drinking their beer, and they're all kind of miserable. And one guy's up there and he's happy. And that's what they say, they coulda, woulda, shoulda, did, right? Because three shoulda, coulda, woulda, but the one guy did. So make sure you're a doer. Liquidity, know your return on investment. And Jason mentioned that you can take on smart debt. You can take on debt that gets your return. And that's part of your strategy. You may go on a part of your plan that says, you know, at that point, I'm really going to have to go out and borrow money or get an investor and give up some equity because I need to go from here to here. And that's a return on investment. You're getting money to do something. There's a return. That's very smart. As long as you know what you're doing, right? There's reasoning around it. So just understand that. We had an advisor here a few months ago, and he was like a junior Dragon's Den or something, technology Dragon's Den. It was Matthew Hyatt.
Michael Hyatt,
yeah. Right. He brought this up. He brought out the first column, the left one and the middle one. And he said, and I've seen this a number of times, and it gets to your customer's pain again. What's the before is the day in the life, how things are today. The Uber, how it was. Here I am in Paris, midnight, snowing. All I want to do is get a taxi. It's going my way, a couple of blocks to get back to my hotel. That's my pain. That was the day before. And you should write this down. You can do this on a spreadsheet. I would advise you do that. The next one is the day in the life after you bring your solution here. So you can see a clear difference. Here's where it was like before, and here's where it's like now, right? The gloom and doom of before, and now it's all rosy and sunshine, and the sun's come up, and the flowers are blooming, and all that kind of nice stuff. But that's what the analogy is, right? Here's where it was before, the pain, here's the solution. One thing that we added was the third column, is where's the math? How do you sustain your business? Show your revenue models and your forecast. Do that in Excel spreadsheet. Whenever I talk to someone about their business plan, one of the things I would ask them is, what's your gross margins and your net margins? You got it? That's good. You know they've got it together. You get that kind of a blanks there, you know, this is going to be a long discussion because You got to get that. Got to understand gross margins, net margins, profit margins, call it EBITDA, whatever you may want. But this is where the math comes in. Paying before, my solution, here's how I'm going to make money resolving that problem. This is the connector I was telling you about earlier. You'll see in here, you go onto the website, you sign in to get a profile, so you sign up, then they'll send you a password, the usual stuff with the profile. And this was built by Alberta Innovates to help connect companies who could be looking for your product or service. In other words, they're looking for a solution. You see the number of tabs in the bottom there. The large one is on the left-hand side, is funding all the funding programs that's available to entrepreneurs in this province are in there. There's programs, our programs will be in there, there's services, but the most important one when you're starting up is the profile matching. So you go in and you start up your profile, and you're telling the world all the stuff you do. Right? Now, there's good news and bad news about that, because as with everything on the internet, all your proprietary information could be out there. So be careful of the information you put in your profile, right? The downside is, the more information you can put in your profile, the better matches you're going to get, right? So just think about it that way, that companies may be looking for your service, and they find all these matches because they can see what you can do, and that's where the matchmaking happens. And then there's events. Some of the events that we would have like this would be posted on their products and services. And I'm just going to show you, there's an example. It's probably hard to see, maybe hard to see for you folks dialing in. But this is just an example of some of the tabs. This is for funding. And you see here, this person has selected environment, food and agriculture, forestry. They want access to expertise. They want access to funding. And they want to acquire equipment. And this has a list on it. I think there's a list of 22 different funding agencies here that match that criteria. So that's just an example. I didn't want to go into too much detail. You'll see it if you go on to connectica.ca. So, wrap up some tips for you. I've talked about this, measurable milestones, realistic revenue models. In a business plan, there's a good argument that would say, if you can't measure it, don't do it. If you ever worked for a large corporation and you ever have to do goals and objectives, like some of us have to, they'll always say that. If you can't measure it, don't do it. Same with your business plan. Make sure it's realistic, though. Right. Constantly seek ways to learn about business, like you're doing today. Never ends, right? We too are always learning about new business methodologies. So there's no real expert in everything out there. So you want to learn all the time. Take every advantage you can to go to free seminars, sessions like this, programs, because you're really building up your portfolio of knowledge around your business. The more you can do that, the better chance of success you'll have. Now, we don't typically recommend any one company, but I'm going to talk about this one. And it talks about finance, financial advisors. There's a company called Maxim Management in town here. Young lad, I don't think he's that young anymore, but Obed Maurice runs Maxim Management. And he was the first top 40 under 40 in Lethbridge through Chamber of Commerce. And his business has really grown. His business has grown because he understands his customers. He's an accountant. But he uses technology in accounting. Really a bit of a twist in that industry. And it's a model for a lot of people, I think, where you have a traditional industry, accounting, traditional ways of doing business, traditional outcomes, and now you have a company who uses technology and has expertise in accounting. He works with companies to manage their everyday finances in cash flow, for example. So that's one I would recommend because he helps companies. Encourage you to talk to Obed. Connect with mentors and business advisors, just like you're doing here. The more the better. Every chance you get, whether it be an advisory committee, friends, family, take them out for lunch or coffee to get their advice, always seek them out. Because they always give you a little bit of a different twist on your business. I haven't thought about that. Or, you know, I didn't think I could do that. But maybe I'm going to change a little bit and I'm going to do that. I never thought. And it's all to help you along your journey to success. Right? Planned networking. Earlier on, I talked to you about networking. Make sure it's purposeful. That's so true. I had a group of young scientists from the university here, very smart people, and developing a product in pharmaceuticals, and they were going to go to a trade show in San Francisco, one of the largest trade shows of its kind in North America, from big pharma companies are there. So I asked them, well, what's your plan? What's your strategy for networking? Well, we're just going to go there and kind of walk around booths and give them business cards and talk to them about what we do. I said, if you're going to do that, don't go. You're wasting your time and money. Don't do it. So we sat down for a half a day working out a strategy for this trade show. The better thing to do is look at all the delegates in the trade show. Pick out all those companies that you really want to have face time with. And you know that, okay, first morning, you go and hit up that company and be very strategic. Don't do it through coffee break. Don't do it through lunchtime because it won't be there. Hit them usually in the morning because in the afternoon they're all tired standing there all day, right? Make meaningful connections. And maybe that means following up for a coffee or dinner or maybe taking them for a drink, whatever it may be. But you got to make that meaningful connection. As soon as you get home, shoot them an email. It's great to have met you in San Francisco. The next time you're in Southern Alberta or in Canada, whatever it may be, I'd like to meet up with you because I'd like to continue the discussion. So you made that memorable connection. And it could be in town too. It could be things like linking with Chamber of Commerce and their trade shows. So you want to be in front of people and make that memorable connection. Plan your networking. Don't just let it happen. Make sure you make those valuable connections with the real people you want to meet and use your time wisely. And you can connect with local, like I mentioned, local Chamber of Commerce if you're in Lethbridge. If you're outside of Lethbridge, there's people like Southrow Regional Alliance and Alberta Southwest Economic Development. There is the EDO's Economic Development Officers in the towns and villages. Link up with them. They connected with us. We meet them once a quarter. All the EDOs from now, the ones from Okotoks are even coming to our meetings. We all meet together and talk about projects. So again, you want to connect everywhere in this journey of business. Connect with everyone you can. Chamber of Commerce is good. But be very selective in your advertising. It can be very expensive. Know your customer. Know your customer persona. The customer persona would be, if you think of the ideal customer for your product, it could be age, gender, location, income, whatever it may be, education. So you know that if I can get my product in front of that customer, they're going to buy it. They will. They just know it because they're a perfect customer for me. So why are you trying to advertise your product to the whole world? Advertise it to that customer. Particularly if you have a web page, make sure that when you is any of you setting up your web page? If any of you have you set up your own, or did you get someone? Because my advice is, unless you're really, really, really good at it, don't set up your own. It's an art to it. It's not just a picture. And the art is, how do I attract people to my website? That perfect customer that we're going in looking for this one liner, one word that looks for that product, it's going to come to my website. There's a real art to that. So make sure you deal with people who know how to set that up. Because You want to advertise or have your website set up and have your connection set up so you attract those ideal customers that you know once they've done their 2, 3, or 4 clicks, next is a buy or a phone call or a meeting, or you go and give them an estimate. So make that connection, but do it wisely. Know your limits, yes. Go out and spend a whole bunch of money thinking that you're going to, the returns are going to happen overnight. It's part of your strategy. You ask, well, Bill, how do we know that? Well, that's why you talk to advisors. That's why you talk to people like Jason and the folks in Community Futures, because they can help you through that stuff. You know, the tracking business is never a straight line, as you all know, right? It goes up and down. But when catastrophes happen, and they will, you can at least pull out the yellow plan that says, and I don't like this, but at least I know how to get around it. And it's not, I'm throwing this out the window, to heck with it, I'm giving up. If you have a plan that obviously is going to track in the right direction for you, but you have to put in some what ifs in there. What if the exchange rate in the US dollar goes to 70 cents? Yikes. But it can happen. Well, my business is going to collapse. Well, if you had a plan, maybe you could say, okay, I'm going to do this and this, and focus on the Canadian market and do this, this, and this. So it's not, it's troubling, yes, but it's not a catastrophe, and I allowed for that. I allowed for that in my plan. The valley of death, right? I don't have to talk about that anymore, because after these next few days, you're going to know that. I talked to you earlier about some events. This is one of the ones in the circle here. Unfortunately, you missed one called the Discovery Program from noon till like 3 o'clock in that chart there. Discovery Program, which you've done now, was really to discover your customers. So unfortunately, you're going to have to wait till next year to do this. All these programs from A, B, C, and D are all free for you, including C, which is Chinook Entrepreneur Challenge. Hopefully you can read it up there. But that's where you are now. The next one that's coming up, as I mentioned earlier, is the Validate program. And we work with Innovate Calgary to deliver that. These programs are all put together with a very clear purpose. We have this under A there. It's called a 3-day startup. Very intense weekend. Starts on a Friday night. Get a group of people together. You come up with an idea, any idea. Put the teams together. By Sunday night, they've developed a theoretical business around that idea. And they make a pitch. Very intense, a lot of fun. We did that last fall. That led into the Discovery Program, which we did. And that's led into this program, which is Chinook Entrepreneur Challenge. Some of these other programs are relatively new. This is your 13th year?
Yeah.
Right? I always talk about this program here. Of all the programs I've seen, certainly in Alberta, with all these other RINs and all the other, the 10 other TDAs, there's no other program like this. So you're really lucky. Not just at the end where you can do your pitch, but all the training you're getting from people who've been there, done it. There's nothing like that. So that's where you are today, under C. You're at the Chinook Entrepreneur Challenge. The end of next month, the end of March, so end of this month, 1st of March, isn't it? We're going to start the Validate program. And that can lead into a go-to-market program. That can be rather expensive. It's probably a $4,000 or $5,000 program. It costs you a couple of $1,000s. You go up to Calgary for that. Very intense. Not for the weak minded, that's for sure. It's very intense. But if you're at the right point, it's very good. But I would suggest you focus on this, what you're doing here, and then this here. And this is the Validate program. You'll see here where to register. See, there are 4 sessions. They're all at the university here. I think probably in this building. The Validate program talks about this minimum viable product again and how it helps you to develop a product or service to the point where customers will want it. How you refine your minimum viable product, how you can take it to market. And then you can refine your business model and look for other opportunities. So the first, they're all free, these are free. The folks from Innovate Calgary come down and deliver it here. And as I said, the first one is during the day, mind you, mostly all Thursdays, end of March, in April, May, and then the end of June. Then that leads into the go-to-market program. So you can see the suite of programs that you're lucky to be available to you, most of them free. Starts you out from getting an idea and starting a theoretical business to validating your idea and talking to customers. It's well structured. And we are the only region in the whole province that does this. The only one that does it like this. Because we believe that we are here to serve you as the customer and you as the entrepreneur and then eventually the client. So look it up. Hopefully you'll register, Eventbrite. Registrations are open now. And I mean, certainly encourage you, because obviously you're serious about your business. That's why you're sitting here, right? And you want to continue to take your business to other levels. And I've talked to you earlier about surrounding yourself with advisors, getting business advice. This is a continuation of that. That's me. Business cards are out there, so call me and email me.